In jiu-jitsu and in martial arts in general, it's very, very common for people to use honorifics in front of your name. Professor Kesting, Sifu Kesting, Sensei Kesting, Master Kesting. And I can't count the number of times I've had an interaction with someone online where they ask me a question and I realize they're trying to be polite. I realize they're trying to show respect by using these terms. You know, Professor Kesting, I really like your videos. I've got a question. Should I train with a broken toe? Blah, 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 blah. I'll try to answer it, and then I'll almost always finish, and please call me Stephan. The number of people that I have told to please call me Stephan is probably in the thousands. That's because I personally do not like the term professor. I personally do not like the term Sifu, Sensei, Master, Sijo, Grandmaster. I don't like these honorifics, especially when they're applied to me. I mean, you do what you want, but this is my video, this is my podcast. I'm going to talk about why I don't like it. The problem is that we're in a hierarchy, and there's an inherent amount of adulation in a pursuit that at least tangentially claims to be spiritual or have spiritual aspects. And when you have this hierarchy and you reinforce it with these terms, it really sets up situations of abuse. I've been training for 40 years. I've got a black belt in a whole bunch of different systems. I've got instructor certification in a bunch of different systems, and that's cool. Presumably, I can teach you something about punching somebody in the nose, choking them unconscious, or breaking their leg. That's the knowledge, that's the stuff I'm certified to teach because of those certifications. Hopefully, along with those black belts, comes some measure of teaching ability, but that's not guaranteed. There are lots of people who are really, really good black belts, really, really good competitors, who can't teach their way out of a paper bag. They lack the pedagogy, they lack the teaching methodology, but that's another rant for another day. Bottom line, that black belt just means that I'm pretty good at what I do martial arts wise. It doesn't even mean that I'm a good teacher. Hopefully I'm a good teacher, but it doesn't mean that I'm a good teacher. What it certainly doesn't mean is that I'm also a doctor. Some of the worst medical advice I've ever received has been from really experienced martial artists. I've had kung fu teachers, you know, look at, examine injured legs and go, "You're fine." And then later gone to a real doctor and goes, "No, you're really injured, you need surgery." I've had martial arts teachers or friends who are martial arts teachers try and talk me out of getting a kidney transplant surgery because my kidneys were failing from a polycystic kidney disease genetic condition, urging me to try curing this with herbs and crystals. I'm not kidding, I wish I were. I've had really experienced MMA coaches try and tell me that my osteoarthritis, which I had in my hip replacement, could be cured by taking digestive enzymes. These are terrible pieces of medical advice, and that's to be expected because martial artists are not doctors. Being able to punch somebody in the throat does not mean that they're good at giving you medical advice. Similarly, most martial artists are not qualified to give you financial advice. They're not any more qualified to give you financial advice or investing advice or crypto advice or NFT advice than your buddy Bob that you go to the bar with, because they've spent their life working on their martial arts skills. They have not spent their life studying financial skills. The trouble is, when we elevate somebody in one area, when we say this guy's really, really good at takedowns and his guard passing's amazing too, we tend to conflate expertise in one area with expertise in another area. He's good at takedowns, your brain goes, therefore the advice he's giving me about NFTs must also be valid. Now, this really is the most important part. A black belt, the title professor, the title guru, guro, sifu, crew, tuhan, master, grandmaster, does not translate to any kind of meaningful equivalence in moral or ethical issues. If you're going to let somebody teach your kids, try to take away the title. Try and take away the trappings, try and take away the uniform, and ask yourself, would I let this person associate with my children if they didn't have the title Grandmaster? If you're a girl and you're thinking about dating your jiu-jitsu instructor, try and take it outside of the jiu-jitsu area. Try and take away the title Professor. Try and take away the title Master. Try and take away whatever crazy title they've given themselves and ask yourself, would I date this dude if those titles didn't exist? Don't let the association with a title or the role that they play in the jiu-jitsu area or the martial arts area, the fact that they're a teacher, cloud your judgment when you're trying to make judgments about their moral character and about whether they're good human beings. We don't do this with people in other areas. It does seem like it's specific to the martial arts, I think because there's a spiritual component to it. We don't go to our car mechanic and ask him questions about medical advice and expect to get good advice. We don't go to that car mechanic and say, hey, you know what? I'm gonna go fly an airplane next week. Why don't you take it up in the air? Why don't you land it? You're good at repairing cars, therefore you must be good at landing airplanes. We don't do that. But we do assume that because somebody's a martial artist, that he has all kinds of other things to give us. They may. If the dude also did a whole bunch of financial planning, if the guy was a financial planner in his previous life and then teaches martial arts on the side, great. Listen to the financial planning advice stuff too. But just having expertise in one area does not give you authority or expertise or gravitas in another area. It's funny that we don't transpose this need to add on these extra titles, master, sifu, sensei, sijo, to other areas. If I was to go ice climbing with Will Gadd, one of the best ice climbers in the world, as paying him to show me how to ice climb, I wouldn't say, Master Gadd, am I doing this correctly? Except if I was doing it ironically, which I might do. But if I was being serious, I'd say, hey, Will, I'm having difficulty, I don't know, making an anchor here with this sling and this piece of ice. What am I doing wrong? If I was taking tennis lessons from Serena Williams, I wouldn't call her Mistress Williams or Master Williams or Sifu Williams or Sensei Williams or some other term. It'd be Serena or maybe Miss Williams. We don't do this in other physical areas. So I think martial arts is specifically vulnerable to it. And I think in the last year, there have been some very high profile sexual scandals that have come out in the martial arts community, in the jiu-jitsu community in particular, but it's nothing new. This stuff has been going on forever. There were bad examples of this 20 years ago, 10 years ago, last year, this year, and there will be next year as well. And again, it's because we put these people up on pedestals. So I'm anti-hierarchy in general, and I'm anti putting people on pedestals. There's a book called Everybody Poops, and you should read it. It's very short. I'll skip to the chase. Everybody poops. The guy's got the name Sijo in front of him. He poops. The guy's got the name Master in front of him. He poops. The guy's got the name Professor in front of him. He poops too. Now, some people go, but Stephan, all professor means in Portuguese is teacher. Professor is the Portuguese word for teacher. Sure. But when we bring words into English, they bring meaning with them. Here's two silly examples that'll get the point across pretty quick. Imagine if we were studying a Papua New Guinean martial art, an art that's just found in Papua New Guinea. And the word for teacher in this hypothetical Papua New Guinean martial art was pedophile. Sounded a lot like pedophile. Do you think for one second that if we were training this, that we wouldn't come up with a new name for teacher? Of course we would. Because nobody would want to have the word pedophile, which means something completely different in Papua New Guinea. It means teacher of martial arts, say, because it has meaning in English. Similarly, if we were doing another martial art, I don't know, we're doing an Albanian martial art, and I don't know Albanian, but let's assume the word in Albanian for teacher is something like great God. Good God. Do you really think we'd be running around going, great God Kesting, could you please show me the reverse punch? No, because the word great God, when we bring it into the English language, has a different meaning. Similarly, professor has a different meaning. The word might mean teacher or coach in Portuguese, but when you bring it into English, it comes with a whole bunch of baggage. So that's why I don't like being called Professor Kesting. That's why I don't like being called honorific anything. Call me Stephan. Now I realize that once again, I'm swimming against the stream here. I'm gonna run into a lot of opposition. People at the top of this hierarchy, instructors, like the term professor because it feeds their ego. It makes them feel like they're special. And the people at the bottom of the hierarchy, just the plain old students in the school, they actually like it too, a lot of them. It gives legitimacy to their training. When they go to work and they're sitting around the water cooler and they're talking about training, it sounds a lot cooler to say, I train with Master Smith, as opposed to, yeah, I train with Jim Bob. Just by name dropping somebody, Master Smith, that sounds a lot more woo-woo, a lot more Asian, a lot more secretive, a lot more inner knowledge, a lot more you know, basically getting superpowers if you're training with a master smith. We like titles. We like titles. It's cool that Dr. Strange goes to study with the Ancient One. The Ancient One sounds a lot cooler than Susie Smith. Right? Like it's got a certain cachet. But it also comes with a whole bunch of shutting off your critical thinking skills. If you're training, if Master Smith tells you to do something, yes, Master, you're probably going to do it, even if it's not good for you. And that's in the martial arts context, because ultimately you are responsible for your own training, you're responsible for your own safety, and you are responsible for your own progress. But where it gets super creepy is when that starts edging outside the field of martial arts. And you're just much more likely to lend Master Smith a whole bunch of money than you are to lend Jim Bob a whole bunch of money. In the pseudo-spiritual realm of the martial arts, it can feel very comforting to be training under somebody with a great big glorified title. But I don't like it. Everybody poops. You are responsible for your training. Other people can help you, but only you are responsible for keeping yourself safe. You are responsible for making good decisions. You are responsible for taking the good things that your teacher has and throwing away the bad things that your teacher has. I've gotten great advice and bad advice from some wonderful people. And it was a little bit easier to sort out the wheat from the chaff when I was just on a first name basis with them. So if you're ever corresponding with me online, if we ever run into each other at the airport or walking down the street, please, you know, if you can't remember my name, the grapple arts guy, that's pretty good. If you can remember my name, hey, Stephan, how's it going? That's what I would like to hear when we run into each other.